Well, good morning and welcome to New Hope Community Church. It's great to have you with us today. That picture up there that you're looking at, that's a portion of the guys who were at Shaver Lake last week on a men's retreat. They were up there Friday night and Saturday night, came back Sunday afternoon. There was 45 of them. And as you can tell by that, they ate very well up there, all right? There's no question about that. And they had a great time. I'm still hearing good reports from it. But it's great to have you with us today. If you are a guest for the very first time, you honor us by your presence here. Thank you so very much for coming. There's a communication card in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to take one, fill it out, put it in the offering bag when it comes by, and then next week through the mail, not at your doorstep, no bothering you on the phone, but in the mail, we'll send you some information that tells you what New Hope believes, what goes on around here, what the ministries are, and we'd love to get that information in your hand, hopefully answer most of the questions you might have about us. I'm going to take a couple minutes to be personal because a lot of you have asked me questions about a few things that have been going on in my world, so let me just take care of a few of them right now. Number one, I am off of jury duty. It's great relief. What was supposed to be 4 days turned into 9 days of jury duty. It was not a pleasant trial. It was a very unpleasant trial. I am grateful for God's providence. There are I have three positive takeaways from 9 pretty ugly days. One is, because I had to go downtown, I was able to go by Dutch Brothers Coffee 3 times. And I don't usually get to go by Dutch Brothers, so that was a good takeaway. Number two, there are two of the individuals on jury duty who told me on our last day, we are going to come visit New Hope Church. Okay, and so that's pretty exciting, all right? They have kids. One moved to the area, hasn't found the church home yet. The other one, actually, her and her husband and high school kids are neighbors of ours, just a block around the corner from where we live. And so that's a big positive. The third thing, which really caught me by surprise, on the last day, Wednesday, we had to go in. That was a day for deliberation. Because I stopped at Dutch Brothers, I was not 20 minutes early as I normally was. I was just 5 minutes early, all right? And so I was in the last group of 3 who went in. The other 9 jurors were already in the jury room. And so when we walked in and sat down, 2 of the jurors looked at me and said, we have appointed you jury foreman. I said, since you all have expressed such democracy, I'm going to ask for a request, and it's perfectly okay if just one of you says that makes me uncomfortable. That's not a problem. But I said, last night when I went to bed, I said, what I really went to bed thinking about was the decision that we make today is not just going to impact one person's life. It's not just the defendant sitting at the table, but there are children that he has that this decision will impact his life. There is the victim, all right, and how this decision impacts her. And this victim has family members. There are law enforcement personnel, all right, who have been engaged in this. And so the decision that we've been entrusted to make is far more encompassing than what we initially think it is. And I said, I'm not smart enough to make those kind of judgments. And so I spent some time last night praying, and I'm wondering if that's the way we could start our deliberations as a jury. But I will only do that if it's unanimous. And before I could say, we're going to write down our answer, yes or no, all 11 hands went up and said, let's pray. And so we started our jury deliberations with prayer, and that was a sweet moment in an ugly 9 days. And so, anyway, I'm finished with that. Now, before you hear some bad things about me, I need to get 2 other things out in the open. First off, if you've been here for a while, you've heard me when I've preached sermons about family life, marriage, those kind of things in Bible studies on marriage. You've heard me challenge men. There are 2 things that you never buy your wife for her birthday. All right, one, never buy her a lawnmower, and never buy her a vacuum cleaner for her birthday, okay? I have said that for years. Tomorrow is Shelly's birthday. She's a trick-or-treat baby, all right? I gave her her birthday present yesterday, okay? So before, I did not buy her a lawnmower. Okay. If you were here a couple of weeks ago, on the Make a Difference in the Life of Your Family, one of the points that I talked about was we need to learn to love others the way they need to be loved. Okay? Remember that? We try to love people the way we want to be loved, and that's not always the same way that other people want or need to be loved. So, I tried to apply that principle, which is what overrode the other thing that I had been teaching, because what Shelly got for a birthday present was a new Dyson vacuum cleaner, okay? It was at the top of her list, okay? More than anything else, that is what she wanted, okay? So I tried to love her the way she wanted to be loved, all right? So now the third thing I need to get off of my chest is on my way home from a memorial service in Keensburg yesterday, as I got to downtown Fresno on the freeway, I got pulled over by a California highway patrolman. He had every right to pull me over. I was engaged in an infraction. I'm not going to tell you what I was engaged in. It can be two or three different things. It is none of your business what I was doing. I'm confessing, okay? This highway patrolman had every reason to pull me over, and I pulled over on the side of the road. I rolled down my side window on the passenger side. I looked up in my rearview mirror. I recognized the face of the highway patrolman getting out of his vehicle, and he was a member of New Hope Church. Have you all heard the story yet? All right, yeah. So when I saw who it was, I laid my arms over my steering wheel, and I hung my head, and he walked up, and he said, "Pastor Tim, how are you today?" And I said, "I was having a great day till a moment ago," and I said, we had a grand time. He showed me marvelous grace. He didn't give me what I did deserve.
He never lets anybody go.
Okay. So, yeah, he'll use it against me one of these days. I'm confident of it. All right, but that's okay. That's okay. It was a wonderful visit. What I found out is he's going to be on vacation for 6 weeks, and he gets to be in church starting next month. All right, so I'm excited about that. All right? But anyway, so I'm through with all of my confessions, okay? And we can move right along with the rest of the day. All right, I just got this last night, all right, but there is a special event taking place this afternoon besides our Harvest Fest, and let me go there first. Harvest Fest has been scheduled for today for months, and as you can tell, the weather is not cooperating fully with our original Harvest Fest plans and festivities. This was to be bounce house, outdoor barbecues, and everything. So here's the deal. After the service, you can still eat here, all right? It's just you don't have to eat outdoors. The food is being prepared indoors, and you will head to the Jam Center where the kitchen room is, okay? And you'll go down the line in there. That's our 5th and 6th grade room, and you'll get your food. You can have, there's Polish dogs, hot dogs, chili, chips, beverages, all right? So you can go over there, get your food. You could go into the high school room and eat, all right, where it's dry and comfortable. If you want to come out on the pavilion, I'm sure that will be acceptable as well. But anyway, that's the way food's going to go, and the games are going to be indoor games. There'll be no bounce houses, but there's going to be face painting, and actually, I have no idea what the other things are they're doing. But the games will be inside. Probably won't go as long now either as well. So it'll be right afterwards. And at that same time, are those who've been engaged in our homeless ministry outreach, they are having a meeting. Get your food and go on over to the office building, to the big room on the back side of the office, and our homeless outreach meeting will take place there. But what I received last night, and something I think is pretty significant that's going to be happening in downtown Clovis today, it's called Bring Them Home. Justin Bond and John Cook are completing a 2,200-mile ride. They started at Canada, went all the way to the border of Mexico, and are coming back to the city of Clovis. These are two military personnel, two vets. They are also two amputees. They have service dogs. They have been riding 2,200 miles. They've been riding in Zoom chairs, averaging 10 miles an hour as they travel. They will be arriving approximately around 2 o'clock in downtown Clovis. They're going to have a gathering in front of the Clovis police station and organize a bit of a parade at 3 o'clock. They are going to have their final ride through Clovis on 5th Street to Pulaski. They're going to come back around and end up back at the Clovis Vet Center and the park side, and from 4 to 8, you can take your lawn chairs and you can buy food there. All kinds of food carts, food trucks are going to be set up, and there's going to be a few groups that are going to be doing music out there. You can come and stay and go as you please, and everything that is raised out there is going to go to ourheroesdreams.org. And it's an organization that helps support veterans who are amputees. So that's going on this afternoon. Yes? Inside the Clovis Memorial Building. All right. And they will have all that information there. So you can show up at any time today and honor that wonderful act that those vets have done. Going to send around a sign-up sheet. And the bottom sign-up sheet on both of these has been around last week. It's for choir members. Choir will meet this Thursday. After this week, it will be on Wednesdays from now until you share at Christmas time. The top sheet is something that's never, ever been passed around at New Hope before. It's a new part of a ministry. That somebody had this brilliant idea, and it made great sense. And so a request was made to our board for Winds of Hope, which is the way we can start new ministries with some seed money. And so what they asked for was for an upright freezer, all right, that we can put on the premises here at church. And here's the way this works. What we're going to put in that freezer is only one thing, food. It is meals that you have prepared that can be frozen. Okay, so you'll get an email that will give you all the details and explanations. But kind of the way this goes is you'll go to, say, Martyr Vaughn's, wherever you shop, and you'll get, you know, the kind of containers that you don't want back, because when you do this, we're not going to look after your containers, all right? You'll put the dish that you have prepared that will feed 4, 6, 8, or 10 people, and they'll give you those explanations as well. Your best dishes, homemade, make them. We will freeze them. One of the ministries we do out of the church is we help young families when they're having a baby. So for 3 or 4 days, we provide food for them so that they don't go hungry. You know, well, mama's kind of busy at that moment. When there is a death in a family, we try to help families for a couple of days around there with food as well to be of assistance. And sometimes where the challenge is those needs are immediate. We can't plan too far in advance. We get a call today and the need is today. And we can get usually plenty of volunteers for the next day or the day after. But sometimes the day of, it's challenging. So here is a way that we could be prepared for immediate needs right now. And we'll have main dishes frozen and in the freezer. They will be dated, the date prepared, and the expiration date, when we probably shouldn't keep that in the freezer anymore. Now, we won't waste it. Because what we'll do is, when it's close to expiration date, we'll give it to Celebrate Recovery for Thursday night dinners, okay? Celebrate Recovery likes that idea. If we miss some and they're after the expiration date, we're going to give it to the Eccles for the college students in our church for their ministry, okay? So we won't waste any of it, all right? I got some college students in here. It's good, though. It's homemade, all right? And they have very strong constitutions. So if you would be willing to be a part of that, and I know you don't have all of the explanations for it right now, but with your email address and or phone number, they will get that to you before you start. But we just wanted to get the sign-up sheet going. We'll tell you when the freezer is in place and ready to receive things to go in there. And you know, every once in a while, the pastor might forget his lunch and just be really hungry on... Just kidding. He could do without a meal or two. All right, let me highlight some announcements very quickly and then a few prayer requests. Today, remember, is a day that your 1040i pledges are due if you made those back in August. November the 17th, the Luis Palau, the citywide event. You need to go online, all right? Go online. You can type in Luis Palau. You can type in City Fest. You can type in Renew Gathering, all right, and you'll probably get to it. You can get 5 tickets when you sign. If you don't do that, but you want a ticket, call the church office and give us your name, and we will try to go online and get those tickets for you. But do your best to do that yourselves. I hope to have 100 people from New Hope at that event that night, all right? It ought to be a great night at the Save Mart Center. Luis Palau will be speaking, and Francis Chan will also be speaking that evening. I've already explained that in that. Homeless Outreach Ministry, I told you they're going to have that meeting at 12:30. Closed to drop off, all right, to Prison Fellowship. There's a table out there in the pavilion. Don't forget to move your clocks back next Saturday night when you go to bed. If you don't, you will show up a little late for the earlier service. Okay, so don't forget to move your clocks backward 1 hour. Now, when you do that, leave for church a little earlier. Okay, because there's a marathon in Clovis next week on Sunday, and they will have some of the streets blocked off that you might normally take to get to New Hope, so you might have to find another direction, another path to get here. So take note of both of those things. On November the 8th is going to be the Primetimers Thanksgiving Luncheon. Turkey and Roland dressing, I understand, and you bring the side dishes and desserts. This is always the biggest one of the year. Out of the first two services, we've already got approximately 40 who are going to be here for that. They need an RSVP. They've asked for it. They sent out some emails, but I know how many of you seniors have emails and read them and or respond to them, so we're going to do a show of hands right now, okay? If you already know you're going to attend the senior luncheon, would you raise your hand? That's a week from Tuesday. Hold it up while I do a quick count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's more you seniors than 5 on this side. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21. All right, so we look to have about 60 to 65, okay? So let's plan for 75. All right, very good. Okay, now some praise, honor, and prayer requests. Mark Addis. Give him kudos when you see him today. He preached yesterday at the Garden of Innocence Memorial Service. We were late getting that information. I sent out an email. I would love to be able to push that a couple of weeks in advance, and maybe the next one we can get 40 or 50 from our church. I know we had some because they sent me pictures of Mark while he delivered the message there yesterday. I had a funeral in Keensburg, and so he went there. If you're not familiar with the Garden of Innocence, this is a memorial service. I think it was 9 children yesterday. These are infants who are either stillborn, they were abandoned and died, a mother after a stillbirth just left the hospital, wanted nothing to do, and so there's an organization in town that takes these abandoned and discarded children, infants, instead of them just staying in the coroner's office on a shelf. They have been given permission to take them. They give them names. They write a poem in tribute to their life. And then they have a ceremony at a place at Mountain View Cemetery. They've created this beautiful place. It's called the Garden of Innocence. And each of these infants are buried there. And they are called by name. In fact, one of the most moving things for me is all the people who show up, they make a gigantic circle around the Garden of Innocence, and each one of those infants and the urn that they are in with their name engraved on the top of the urn are literally passed around so lovingly by everybody who's present. Every one of these children are held before they are delivered to their place in the Garden of Innocence. And Mark had a chance to preach a message of hope at that service yesterday. So give him kudos when you see him today for being available to do that. And what a wonderful organization that we have in our community that will take care of those who have been disposed of. Not one human life should be treated that way. And I am so grateful for grace and kindness that's been shown here. Some prayer requests that's not in your bulletin. Cheryl Molinari is having some heart challenges. She's going in for testing this week, and so be praying for them that they will get direction. Lee Childress, who is not sitting next to Steve, it's not because she's mad at him. It's because she's in Korea. The thing, reason I'm bringing her up today is not because she's in Korea, but because she's in the hospital in Korea. It's a long explanation, but basically because of something she ate, okay? Fish in water that was a different temperature than it should be and eating it like sushi, you always ought to cook your bait. And so when you don't, sometimes it creates issues, and that's what happened. And so she's been in the hospital, hopefully gets to go home tomorrow in Korea from the hospital. Brad Sandstrom from our church had a lump moved off of his right pec. He'll know next week what the reports say on that, of whether it was benign or malignant. The assumption at this point is that it is benign. Did a service yesterday in Layton and Keensburg for a gentleman who had been for 21 years the varsity basketball coach at Keensburg High. Go Vikings. And a terrific gentleman, well attended yesterday, but be praying for the McKean family. There's a service this coming Friday for Darren Orr. This is a nephew to Terry and Dana Orr from our church. Died unexpectedly as a result of a car accident. And so please be praying for their family. And that service will be here at New Hope. Carl Ashmore is Christy Miller's uncle. All right, Christy Miller's uncle. And that service will be the following week. And so would appreciate your prayers for them. Charlene Dooms, Bernice Osborne's daughter that we were expecting to hear on Friday, whether her counts were where they need to be so she can get a bone marrow transplant. They did a test on Friday, but we will not have that answer until Tuesday or Wednesday of next week. So continue to pray for them as they are in that waiting room. Those are all of our prayer requests and announcements. Just before our ushers come, I want to remind you, in case you forgot, we're doing two offerings again today, as we did last week. Our first offering is our regular church tithes and offering, and today is Make a Difference Sunday in the month of October. I hope we don't stop wanting to make a difference in our world, but the theme this Sunday is Make a Difference in the World. And so it's looking beyond just what's right in front of us. And one of the ways that we are doing that today is we're reaching all the way to Mexico. Gil Hernandez, who has been our missions pastor for over 25 years, 5 years ago, he said, stop giving me a stipend for the services I do. I'll continue to do my services, but invest that money into our youth program. Gil makes about 8 trips a year for mission purposes into Mexico. He's able to house out of Angelina's home, all right? Angelina married a few years ago. It's where he planted a church. He planted a church in that community over 30 years ago, and that house burned down, okay? Everything in it was destroyed. It was done out of brick, and so all that's left is just the burned bricks. It's a fire that started in a house adjacent to theirs, and it destroyed theirs as well. It's a different culture down there, different government. There's no such thing as we have insurance here, and so just a huge, huge loss. We had several men in our church who wanted to go down there and help rebuild. When we started to look at what the costs were just for transportation, 3 days travel down there, 3 days back, haven't even done one bit of work. You're already out lots and lots of resources. So what we shared with our board this past week, and they have approved, I'm not hanging out on a limb now as I was last week. We have some undesignated mission funds that we always try to have every year for emergencies or something unexpected that comes up. And so they have given us permission to say we will take those funds and match what is given in our offerings today, up to $5,000, so that they continue to have a base of ministry in Mexico to continue to do the work that they do there. Gil really knows nothing about this, all right? They are coming home. I got an email from him because in order to get his hearing aids, which burned up in the fire, VA said he has to pick them up by the 10th. Or they're going to go to somebody else because he's been gone for a while. So they're coming home, I think, Wednesday of this week. We'll be here about 10 days and then go back to oversee the work that's going on in their home there. That offering will be taken at the end of the service. If you're writing a check for that offering, just make it to New Hope. But on the envelope, just write Mexico House or Hernandez Home, whichever you use. It'll make sense to the staff that counts that tomorrow. All right, gentlemen, would you come wait on us, and then we'll now get engaged in our worship. Let's pray. Father, I love you. I thank you for your kindness and your generosity and your compassion. Thank you for the way in which you have been at work in all of our lives. And Father, I pray that we give you freedom to make a difference in our lives and then create within us a passion to let you, through us, make a difference in the lives of others. There are some areas in life that it's very easy to allow you to do that. And God, I guess the challenge I hope comes through to all of us is let's not look for the easy places to make a difference, but let's look for the places you call us to make a difference. And so I trust that you'll give us some clarity today, each one of us personally and us as a church family collectively, how we can make that difference. Father, we thank you for your presence and your availability and those who've had surgery recently and their recoveries. For those who are going through treatment or awaiting decisions, we pray for your best at this moment in their lives. Speak to us today, and may we have ears to hear what you say. We trust you for all this in the name of Christ. Amen and amen. I invite you to find two passages of Scripture, both of them in the Gospels. Matthew chapter 28. If you'd turn there, Matthew chapter 28, the last few verses of the chapter. It's actually the last few verses of the book of Matthew. Once you find it, if you'd put a finger there or a bookmark and then flip to the right a few pages and find the Gospel of John chapter 20. The Gospel of John chapter 20. Just a couple of minutes. We'll read John and then we'll read Matthew. I want to tell you a story about Jim today. Jim is a guy who had a huge passion for God and a great love for people. And on top of that, he had an extreme burden for a mission of communicating the gospel of Christ to others who might not know him. Jim wrestled with the question of how he could bring the gospel of Christ and do a significant job in a setting that seemed so very difficult for him. How could he help people see and embrace the truth when they had so little biblical understanding? The barriers in front of Jim seemed insurmountable, and the task appeared virtually impossible. Even with all of the obstacles in front of him, Jim knew he had to try. It was a God-given mission. It was a vision that he had received to make a difference in the lives of this particular group of men and women. For starters, what Jim decided to do was he shaved his head right down to the skin, except for one patch of hair that he let grow very, very long. Not only that, but he began wearing that patch of hair in a pigtail, and then he dyed it a different color so he would fit in with those that he was trying to teach. He also gave up his suit and his tie, and he began to dress like the people he was communicating with. He even changed his eating habits. He worked hard to learn a new vocabulary and interesting expressions in the hopes he would be able to effectively convey biblical truth in everyday street language. Jim didn't do all of this from a distance. He actually moved into the neighborhood where these people live. He tried to become their friend and neighbor. This was not easy because they had a very non-Christian lifestyle and they had an outright rejection for the ministry of Christ. Jim paid the price of this mission and vision in loneliness and weariness and discouragement. And probably the most hurtful thing was the criticism from many other Christians. He lived daily with rejection by most of those that he wanted to reach so much. Jim did this year after year after year. Jim owned the mission that God had given him. Jim's life is a powerful illustration of evangelism against all odds. And today, in the 21st century, generations later, countless people from the neighborhoods where Jim lived and worked so hard to reach have now come to saving faith in Christ. Is it worth it to take risks to reach lost people with the love of Christ? Is it right to proclaim the gospel in ways that break paradigms, push back boundaries, ruffle a few of our comfortable feathers? If you're not sure, you might want to take the time to ask hundreds of thousands to millions of Chinese believers in Jesus Christ who have been touched directly or indirectly by Jim. Jim is known more widely by his full name, James Hudson Taylor. He was the founder of the China Inland Mission, over 100 years ago. When James Hudson Taylor, when he went to China, this is the story. He did not get to stay in China as long as he wanted. He got to plant only a few churches and disciple a few hundred believers. When he left China, he had no idea what the results might be decades later, when the wall would lift, when the walls would be torn down and Christians were allowed to come into China again. Many of those who criticized Hudson Taylor for going to China and the methods that he used in order to reach the people, they said when the door closed, what a waste of ministry, time, and money. Only to discover decades later, when Christians went back into China, they didn't find a church or a couple of little churches or a few little clusters of believers in huts around China. They found hundreds to thousands of vibrant underground churches, and the numbers of believers were in the hundreds of thousands and possibly into the millions. I would say Jim was right on mission, the way in which he chose to live his life. Circumstances in my own life have provided lengthy opportunities for me to think a little deeper about death. If I knew my time to go on to heaven was near, either through illness or because of advancing age, and maybe that second one is becoming more and more reality, what statement would I want to leave with those I love the most? What challenge would assist them in seeing clearly the responsibility of the life that we have in Jesus Christ? What encouragement would stimulate them to accept it? The resurrected Lord of life had such an opportunity to share with his loved ones. Jesus had sacrificially died, and miraculously he had been raised from the dead. He knew what only God Almighty could know, and he related it as only the man triumphant could before he left earth. God in human flesh, he sounded a clarion call that we who have been born again, we who have, because not of what we have done that caused us to deserve it, but by the generosity of God, shedding the blood of his Son, raising him from the dead so that we could be forgiven of sin and have a promise of a home in heaven, this God who loved us so much, when we enter into a relationship with him, not by religion, but by faith in who Jesus Christ is and what he said he would do, when we are part of God's family, he's given to every one of us, every single one of us, a clarion call for our future. You see, that which we have received from God so graciously, we're not to hoard, we're to share. That which changed the course of our life will change the course of other lives as well. And every single one of us who have been born again, saved, whatever word you want to use, if that's happened to us, we are part of God's family. We are now his disciples. And Jesus had the opportunity to give his last word and testament to his closest disciples before he departed this world. This was not a dying declaration. I've been informed by others in law enforcement that a dying declaration is pretty powerful testimony. But you need to understand, these words I'm going to read to you from Jesus, these are not his dying declaration. He had already died 3 days before. He was now raised from the dead. This is a living declaration, but it's the declaration he gives right before he goes back to heaven. I don't know about you, I think he thought about those words pretty seriously, and I think they're pretty important. So let's look at them. John chapter 20, verse 19. On the evening of that first day of the week. Okay, so what day is it? It's Sunday. First day of the week is Sunday. Seventh day of the week is the Sabbath day. That is Saturday. So on the evening of that first day of the week, which is Sunday, what had happened that morning? The tomb was empty. Jesus was raised. That very morning, Jesus had just walked out of the tomb. All right? That evening, he's going visiting. Okay? Jesus is going on a visit. When the disciples were together with the doors locked, they were hiding out because they were afraid of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them, and he said, "Peace be with you." Probably not the first thing we say when we step into a room, is it? I mean, Jesus didn't even say, "Hi, how are you?" But Jesus addressed what the immediate need was. They were behind locked doors. Why? Because they were afraid. So Jesus stepped in the room and gave them what they needed. He said, "Peace be to you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Remember, Jesus had already been seen by Peter and John and by Mary and a few others, and they had gone back and told the rest of them what had happened. And Thomas, along with probably another one or two, said, "Hey, whoa, you guys have seen him. We haven't. Till we see him, we're not going to believe." Thomas went so far, "Until I put my hand in his side, I'm not going to believe this thing." And so Jesus shows up, says, "Peace be to you," and then he makes himself available. Touch, feel. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. And Jesus repeated himself, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." Parting declaration. As my Father sent me, I'm going to send you. And then Jesus does something really, really peculiar. That just looked really stupid, didn't it? I would say it felt really stupid too. But that's exactly what he did. Don't take my word for it. And with that, he breathed on them. That was a physical reflection of what was happening internally on them. For the first time in human history, since Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden and the Holy Spirit of God departed from the human spirit of man because of sin, for the first time since then, the Holy Spirit of God was now returning to move inside, live inside of them as God intended us to live when he first created us in the beginning of time. But because of sin in Adam and Eve's life and now sin in the world, sin had to be dealt with in the core of our being by the finished work of Jesus Christ, by his death, his burial, and his resurrection. But now that price has been paid. And Jesus, get this, don't miss out on this. Jesus said to those in that room, "As my Father from heaven sent me from heaven to earth," in the same way, with all that the Father is, for everything that I, the Son, am going to need to live my 33 years on the face of this earth, all that the Father is for everything that I need, I'm now giving to you everything that I am that was sufficient to live my life on this earth. I am giving that to you for everything that you need. Why? Because the Spirit of my Father that lives in me is now going to be the Spirit that lives in you. Isn't that great news? That is good stuff. You and I can face every day of life and living, even fulfilling the parting mandate of God in us to go to the world. We have all that God is in us to accomplish what his command is. Have you taken to heart this last word and testament which Jesus left you in John? Let me share with you what he said in Matthew. Matthew chapter 28, verse 16. Flip back over to that passage. "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go." When did he tell them to go there? I suggest to you it was John chapter 20. When he showed up there, he then tells them, "Okay, guys, we're going to go on a retreat." Kind of like 45 guys from New Hope went to Shaver Lake, okay? 11 guys plus Jesus went to the mount, I believe, best I can tell, probably the Mount of Transfiguration. That was not a strange place for them to get away. James and John and Peter had been there with Jesus before. Verse 17, "When they saw him, they worshiped him. But some doubted." Might be kind of like the congregation today. Some of you have come and you've worshiped. Some of you have come and you've doubted. Only you can make the determination which one you are. But here's what I love. Your doubt does not stop Jesus from coming to you. John 20, Thomas doubted. Jesus showed up like, what's her name, and Bewitched. Okay? He just entered the room. Nobody saw him. He entered the room, and he gave peace to those who doubted. Doubts don't keep Jesus away from you. Your doubts keep you away from Jesus. The choice is ours. It doesn't scare him. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age." Notice in these verses that we are talking about a great authority has been given through Jesus Christ. Number two, a great commandment has been shared with his disciples. And number three, a great promise is provided for all of us. Jesus had burst forth a new power from the grave. An unsealed grave was left behind, and he revealed himself to his disciples. He invited them to go to a place in Galilee, this place probably the Mount of Transfiguration, a place where Jesus, Elijah, and Moses had met and had a conversation months, if not about a year, before all of this took place. And I don't know about you guys, that is a Bible conference retreat I would have paid some pretty big bucks to have gone to. All right, when the three keynote speakers are Jesus, Moses, and Elijah, that could have been some pretty exciting stuff. And so that's where they all meet. And then verse 17 tells the disciples' response of seeing Jesus. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. When they saw Jesus, they worshiped. We too need to see. We need to get the vision of Jesus as the risen Lord, and we need to worship. He's conquered the humanly unconquerable foes of sin and the devil and the grave, and the one who is worthy of all glory and honor. If our heart and mind will capture who Jesus really is, it can't help but evoke worship from us. It speaks volumes to me to know that those men who knew Jesus best would worship him the most. There are some of you in here who you know me best, but there is no danger of you worshiping me. But these guys who knew Jesus best worshiped him most. And notice what Jesus did. Verse 18 says, "And Jesus came up and he spoke to them." In spite of their doubts, he spoke. Verse 18 continues and said, "And Jesus came up and spoke to them and said, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth.'" Hear the claim that Jesus makes, which only God can make. He said, "All authority has been given to me, both in heaven and on this earth." You and I, we tend to be people who like power, and we think it's power that gives us authority. In Jesus' world, it's absolutely the other way around. It is when we understand who the authority is that we then have power. Let me see if I can illustrate. My first job at Fresno Bible House, about 40 years ago. It was to direct traffic in the parking lot. I was employed to my capabilities. And it was between Thanksgiving and Christmas, and it was a very busy time. This tells you how long ago it was. There was no 41 freeway anywhere in Fresno. The main thoroughfare, it wasn't Freeway 41, it was Highway 41, and that was Blackstone Avenue. That was how you got, all right? And that was it. So from Thanksgiving to Christmas, it was like L.A. on that street, because that was where everything was. And so there was some construction going on to a building next door to where the Bible House was. Parking had been limited. It was difficult getting in and out. So I got hired to direct people where to park behind the building. And then on occasions, Mr. Jantz told me, "Tim, when it gets too backed up in our parking lot, we need to get cars out. Just step out into the first lane of Blackstone traffic, put your hand up, stop the traffic, and then let the other people out so we can get more customers in, okay?" And I was the employee, he was the employer, I did what I was told, okay? Now, most of the time, and what I did is I never looked at the people I was stopping. I only looked at the people I was letting out. Because, see, I knew I was making those people mad, and I was making these people happy. So I like smiles better than hand signals. And so I would always look at these people. And on one occasion, I remember this car comes up and it hits me in the knee. And then it bumped me again. And then it bumped me again. And finally I looked, and to my surprise, it was a guy who didn't know me, because he wouldn't have recognized me. He hadn't seen me in over 10 years, and I was just a kid. It's a guy I know. He'd gone to Dad's church at one time. He'd been a gang member at one time. He was not a very nice person. Hey? And you see, I had no authority to be out there, and he didn't care. What would have made the difference to him? What if I've been wearing a police uniform? Now I have authority, don't I, to stand out and to direct traffic. I'm looking for the affirmation of a policeman. Yes. See, I have some authority now. I could be the same person, but now in the uniform, I carry the authority of the law on my side. And so he would have stopped, I think. So authority comes from the right. God has the right to be the authority in our world. He has created it. He has paid for it. He has gone beyond the call of duty in that area. And he says, I'm going to give to you my authority. My authority comes from my Father. And once we have the authority, then we get the power to carry out that authority. The second thing in these verses is the great command, verses 19 and 20, go and make disciples of all nations. The first participle in the Greek text that carries the power of command is that two-letter word, go. We are not to wait for people to come to us. We are to go out and to reach them. Get this, church. This is not the Field of Dreams. Okay, you remember the movie? The Field of Dreams. Build it and they will come. Wrong idea for the church to have. We are not to build it and anticipate them flocking to our doors. We may build something, but what we are to do is go get them and bring them back with us. Bring them to a relationship with Jesus Christ, if that is what they want, because it is what they need. Go. This is about being mobile, not stationary. Do I have anybody who took French in high school? Or you are fluent in French. Okay, we have one literate person in our entire church. Nobody in the other two services raised their hand, all right? So I want direction on how to pronounce this word. M-A-G-I-N-O-T. Maginot. Thank you. Two people know French. All right, Maginot. In the 1930s, the French built the famed Maginot Line. It was a defense against the German attack. The ultra-modern fortification of concrete barriers and hardened bunkers was considered to be impregnable. Its concrete was thicker and its guns heavier than the world had ever seen before. But the builders had not counted on the Nazi Blitzkrieg, the lightning war, a rapid plan of attack that emphasized speed and mobility. The fabled defense line of the French became a useless pile of concrete in the face of superior mobility of German armies. What is true in warfare is no less true in Christian evangelism. Jesus knew this. He carried his campaign to the hearts of men into the village, to the marketplaces, to the wells, to the open countryside. In the Great Commission, he commands his disciples, go! Period. Go anywhere. Go everywhere. There are men and women who need me. The last portion of this parting words of Jesus to his disciples is found in verse 20. And lo, I am with you all the days, even to the end of the age. There's a great promise there, the promise of his presence. In the passage we read in John, we have a bonus that comes with his presence. Remember when Jesus entered the room by surprise? He said, peace be with you. When his presence is with us, his peace abides in us. What a challenging command. It demands a great promise. Jesus promised to be with us all the days of our lives when we're on mission. David Livingston, You history buffs remember that name, don't you? Livingston, I presume. He was a world-renowned doctor missionary. By the time he returned to his native country, Scotland, to address students at Glasgow University, the previous 16 years he had spent in service of God on the continent of Africa. As he stood before those young men and women, the tremendous price exacted on Livingston's body was plain to see. More than 27 fevers had coursed through his veins, leaving his body emaciated and ravaged. One arm hung uselessly from his side, the result of being mangled by a lion. The core of his message to those young people that day was this: shall I tell you what sustained me amidst all the troubles and the toil and the loneliness of my time? It was Christ's promise, I am with you always, even to the end. And he went on to say, young people, go, and go in the presence of God, and you will have his peace. What Christ promised to the disciples on the mountain nearly 2,000 years ago is our promise today. Remember John 20? As my Father sent me, I will send you. The presence of God, which Livingston experienced, can be experienced by us today. The companionship of Jesus is offered to every believer as you or I, he or she, makes their way through this world. Whether we are sharing this in the dentist's office, whether we are sharing this across the street, whether we are sharing this across the hallway in our own home, Jesus means for you and I to carry out his great commission. Always means every day of our life, days of strength as well as days of weakness, Christ will be with us. Days of success as well as days of failure, Christ will be with us. Days of joy, days of affliction, days of liberty, days of temptation, days of good health, days of struggling health, days of laughter or sadness, Jesus will be with us. The peace that Jesus says my presence will bring to you, the Bible gives us four dimensions of this peace. First of all, it's peace with God. Romans 5:1 talks about that. When we enter into a relationship with Christ, we have peace in our hearts with God. Second of all, once we have peace with God, John 14 says, I will give you peace in difficult times. Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble, but don't let the troubles of this world tear up your peace. My peace will be with you when things are bad. We will have peace in our relationships. We will learn how to extend forgiveness and how to receive forgiveness when we have the forgiveness of God in our life, according to Ephesians 2. And then one of the thrills, the bonuses of this peace of God is that we will have peace with our past. Romans 8:1 says you don't need to carry the garbage and the gunk of your past, the things done to you or the things you have done to others. Those are gone. There is now no condemnation. There's no sense of guilt in your life because Jesus bore all of our guilt on a cross 2,000 years ago. The Savior offers us peace whether we deserve it or not. By granting peace, Jesus shows us how much he accepts us and loves us. As it relates to our mission, Jesus knows that our fears keep many of us from sharing good news. Guys, I got to be honest. I was a little nervous to ask a jury group if it was okay to pray. Because I had a pretty high risk that one out of 11 could have said no. But I would have never had the joy if I hadn't taken the risk. It's at that moment you had to say, Lord, are you sure you want me to do this? And I'm pretty sure he was. Remember, you will be with him, and he will be with you all the days of your life. We are not alone. I want to wrap this up, and I'm going to wrap it up with something silly. I thought when I first heard this about 40 years ago, I thought it was pretty silly. I hadn't read it or come across it or heard it in a long, long time until this week. And I read it again, and I thought it was pretty silly. And I put it aside, and something kept drawing me back to it. It's something somebody wrote to get a point across. And sometimes the silly things can sometimes make the most powerful point. And so I hope you'll hang with me for about 2 minutes as we try to convey an important point in maybe a rather kind of silly way. 10 little Christians standing in a line, One disliked the preacher. Now there were nine. Nine little Christians stayed up very late. One slept in on Sunday. Now there are eight. Eight little Christians on their way to heaven. One decided to take his own road. Now there are seven. Seven little Christians chirping like some chicks. One disliked the song leader. Now there are six. You guys are getting the hang of this. Six little Christians seem very much alive, but one lost his interest. Now there are five. Five little Christians pulling for heaven's shores, but one stopped to rest. Then there were four. Four little Christians busy as a bee. One got her feeling hurt. Now there are three. Three little Christians knew not what to do. One couldn't forgive the other. Now there are two. Two little Christians, our rhyme is nearly done, quarreled over petty stuff. Now there was only one. One little Christian can't do much, 'tis true, but he brought his friend to Bible study. Now there are two. Two earnest believers, each one more, then doubled their number, and now there are four. Four sincere Christians worked early and late, each one another. Now there are eight. And there's something blocking the top part of my screen. Eight splendid Christians, if they doubled as they did before, in just a few weeks, they'll be 1,024. Kind of silly, isn't it? But it's pretty true, isn't it? And here's the way I want to wrap this up. Suppose that these last words of Jesus, his last will and testament before he departed this world, what if they are the first words Jesus will speak to us when we arrive in heaven? How are we going to respond if he were to ask us, "Have you done with the mission of my great commission? How have you done going to anybody, to somebody, and share my life with them? Who could we bring to him?" The scripture says the harvest out there in the world is plentiful. There are lots of people looking to find Jesus. One of the ladies on the jury, she said, "My best friend in Gilroy had been asking me for years to come to church, and I always had an excuse. And finally, just one day, she said to me, 'Just come with me one Sunday, and I'll never ask you again. Just, you want to shut me up? Just come one time with me.'" And she said, "So I went one time." And she said, "I couldn't wait to go again. There was something." And she said, "Tim, I got to tell you, there's nothing all that creative about church. Okay, people go, they sit, they listen, they sing. But she said, "There is something that did in my life that I can't explain." And you've got friends just like that. The scripture says the harvest is plentiful. Where the problem is there's no harvesters. There's nobody who will go and say, "Hey, come meet Jesus." I don't know where you are in this spiritual life. I don't know if you are a lover of Christ already. Maybe you could be here today and you've never invited Christ in your life. And this message really wasn't designed for you. It was really designed for our regular church family, to challenge us. Yes, we give and we share so that others can go, but some of us need to go. And some who've never shared need to share and be part of the senders. And some of us need to realize, I just need to go across the street or down the block or around the corner. But maybe you're here today and you've heard enough about this incredible love of God and you've heard about his last words to his followers and you're saying, "I want to be one of those followers." Then why not join me in a prayer? It's not a fancy prayer, it's just a humble prayer. Using your own words, you say something like, "Lord Jesus, when I die, I don't want to go to hell, I want to go to heaven. Lord Jesus, I've never thought about the fact, but I've been the God of my own life, and I'm ready to let somebody else take over. So Lord Jesus, would you forgive me of my sin, come live within my life, and then help me discover what it means to be your child?" Use whatever words come to your mind, but convey that truth. And at that moment, you know what just happened? Jesus just breathed on you. And he came to live within you in the presence of his Holy Spirit. You may say, Tim, I didn't feel a thing. They probably didn't either. This is not a feeling. This is a truth. This is a truth. When people tell you the truth, we often don't feel anything. We just know it's the truth. And Jesus says, I come to live within you, to give you everything you need for life and godliness. And maybe for the vast majority of us who are here, part of the New Hope friends and family, maybe we need to pray a prayer something like this. Lord Jesus, I've known you for a long time. And you know, when I'm with Christians, it's easy for me to talk about you, but Lord, I don't want to force anything down anybody's throat, and so I've really not said anything to anybody who doesn't know. God, it's dawned on me today, if somebody hadn't shared it with me, I wouldn't be where I am. So, God, I don't want to be selfish and hold on to what you've so freely given me. I want to discover how I can be part of your last will and testament to the world. I want to go. And I know I probably won't go to Africa, but Lord, if that's where you want me to go, I'll go. I'll go there. But Lord, I may just need to go down the hall to my own child. I may need to go to my office and share with my coworker. Maybe I need to invite a neighbor over whose son or daughter or mom or dad just recently died, and I just need to share with them the difference that you make. God, I pray that you'll find here today many of us willing to say yes to your go. As Major Thomas used to say, sent, went, and put. May we be put where you sent us, and may we be willing to go. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.